No one knew it was a volcano before it suddenly erupted, and within 72 hours' time, it caused the deaths of 2,000 people along with the destruction of three entire settlements. This disaster, which marked one of the deadliest volcanic eruptions to happen on the North American continent, occurred in Canada. Yes, Canada of all places. And yet, few people in Canada know that this disaster ever took place. The setting of our story takes us to central western British Columbia, 760 kilometers north-northwest of Vancouver, to a spot bordered by mountains with small glaciers. There, within the local Crater Creek Valley, is the origin of this destructive eruption. This seemingly small cone, which rises a mere 68 meters or 190 feet above the surrounding landscape, marks the youngest vent of the Tseax Cone volcano. The eruption which formed this vent occurred during a several-month-long time span between approximately 1640 and 1740, with our current best guess being between June and September of 1700. This eruption would create a 32.2 kilometer or 19.9 mile long lava flow which buried any remnants of the tragedy it would cause, as it was not the lava flows that directly killed so many people. This is the story of how what is today interpreted as one of the least dangerous active volcanoes in all of North America led to one of the continent's deadliest eruptions. While the Tseax Cone is the only visibly recent volcanic product in the vicinity, this stretch of Canada has seen more than a dozen volcanic eruptions presumably occur during the last 1 million years, such as at this highly eroded 175,000-year-old lava flow. These vents might all be considered part of a single volcanic field which exists at the southernmost extent of a much broader area known as the Northern Kerguelen Volcanic Province. Here, the crust is slowly spreading apart to the east and west every year by as much as 2 centimeters or 0.79 inches. The aforementioned rifting does not occur along a singular fault or crack, but rather through numerous faults spread out over a wide area which has created numerous half-grabens. These faults create a path of least resistance for molten rock to intrude into, which allows it to intrude into the crust and occasionally erupt. One such fault was utilized presumably after the major Cascadia megathrust earthquake of 1700, causing molten rock to slowly rise through the crust. This generated a swarm of earthquakes which were repeatedly felt by locals. The earthquakes became stronger and stronger until magma reached the surface and created 100-meter-high lava fountains along an 800-meter-long fissure. As lava fell back to the ground, it rapidly flowed downslope and in 6 hours' time had already traveled 5.7 kilometers to reach the Tseax River Valley, also damming the river to the south to form a body of water called Lava Lake. After lava made this turn to the north is when the real tragedy struck. The lava flow and eruption had been emitting substantial amounts of carbon dioxide, sulfur dioxide, and hydrogen sulfide gas, all of which are lethal at varying concentrations and were heavier than residual air. As a result, these toxic gases traveled downhill, being confined by the river valley until it reached a bend in the river where it began pooling to lethal concentrations due to regional topography causing it to become trapped there. As a result, thousands immediately dropped unconscious and died, with a similar fate occurring to those who were sleeping, quietly being asphyxiated en masse. This occurred to three settlements and two additional outlying areas home to the Nishka'a, killing 2,000 people. The advancing basinite to tracky basalt lava continued downslope, eventually burying a fishing camp at hour 17. At hour 23, the lava flow reached a series of smokehouses, and as the lava turned the corner west into the Nass Valley, it diverted the pathway of the Nass River further northwards. The three villages were then completely buried by advancing lava flows, destroying every single structure by hour 45. This lava flow continued to slowly advance during the next 95 days, eventually traveling up to 32 kilometers from its source. A spouter rampart then began to grow, with three sets of vents ejecting moderate amounts of ash and feeding another lava flow which would reach the smokehouses 5 days later. The eruption then paused for a few hours, after which it resumed at only a singular vent as the two satellite vents became inactive. More viscous and gas-rich magma then began to erupt, resulting in the generation of a 5-kilometer or 16,400-foot-high eruption plume, which ejected larger amounts of ash. A cinder cone started to grow during this phase via intermittent explosions of tephra which largely fell close to their source vent, creating a growing cone. The violent Strombolian phase lasted for 10 days, feeding a more viscous A'a lava flow which eventually came to a halt, by which time the final phase of the eruption caused declining activity to collapse part of the northern cinder cone. In total, this eruption lasted for 120 days, covering 37.31 square kilometers or 14.41 square miles in a fresh layer of lava. The lava flows would take more than a decade to completely cool. This eruption proves that under a narrow set of circumstances which vary from volcano to volcano, that even an apparently not very dangerous volcanic system can prove to be quite lethal, which is why each and every world volcano needs to be studied.